I want to talk to you about the catching away of the church. And so I'm going to start again with a question that I asked you Sunday morning, only one question tonight. If you knew, absolutely knew, Jesus was coming, would it impact how you're living today? You would think the answer would be obvious, right? Yeah, absolutely. I mean, if I knew Jesus, so let me just tell you, Jesus is coming. So now you know. Now you do know. He is coming. And why that doesn't impact how you're living today, why that doesn't exhort you, encourage you, admonish you, or rebuke you to live the way God has created you to live as a born-again believer is fascinating to me. But, you know, in order to keep a good attitude, I just say that's job security. Because I've been preaching in this church 28 and a half years, and I have yet to preach myself out of a job. People that need the Word, need the Holy Ghost, just keep coming. Listen to this. Matthew 24, verse 3, the latter portion says this. Tell us, the disciples said, when shall all these things be? And what shall be the sign of your coming and at the end of, and the end of the world? Two separate events. So in Matthew 24, and the great struggle I've had, and I have spent hours studying, praying, seeking the Lord on how to make this subject not palatable, but simple enough, to simplify it enough, where you can just grab it and go, man, all right, I got it now. So here in Matthew 24, because Matthew 24 is kind of an intermingling of both present day events, future events, as well as prophetic events that both relate in some cases to the church and in some cases just to the Jew. And so it sometimes can create some, I don't like the word confusion, it just sometimes causes us, I hope and pray, to be students of the Word. So you really don't just do your, you know, your bread box and just read two or three scriptures and go on, but you become students of the Word. So listen to what this scripture, 24:40, says in Matthew. Then shall two be in the field, one shall be taken and the other left. Two women shall be grinding at the mill, one shall be taken and the other left. Pretty obvious, huh? Wouldn't that be something? 500 at church. 200 left and 300 taken. 301. Now I want you to just think about this. You really believe in the rapture? The catching away of the church? Do you realize that if it were to take place during a church service, there would be people still here? Now I'm not talking about y'all. I mean, would it be wild that if you were visiting a church and you weren't right with God? Let's say you hadn't been born again, but you really felt the drawing of the Holy Spirit, and you show up at church, and at some period of the preaching, the preacher disappears. And the person you were sitting beside that introduced themselves to you right before church, they're gone too. And you're still there. Would that blow your mind? Something like that's going to happen. But see, y'all not worried about it, are you? Because why? Because you're getting ready to go. Going to be a lot of people. So I want you to understand why this is important. It's because y'all planning on going. But see, if you and I are the ones planning on going, do you understand there are going to be a lot of people left? And some of those people we may love, and all those people we're supposed to love. And if that's the case, we ought to be doing the Great Commission. And the Great Commission's not hiring the preacher. The Great Commission is being equipped for the work of the ministry and not just serving in the building and in the service of the body of Christ, but taking this gospel message everywhere we go. All right, so let's keep going. Then there'll be two, right? This word taken implies to take someone to be with you and therefore points to the salvation of that person, the redemption of that person, rather than the destruction of the one taken. Now, I have the ability at our house, we have the ability to watch movies, and there's a thing that we plugged into our device, and it will actually bleep out words. Pretty cool. And I've seen this guy in a movie called Taken. And they took his I think it was his daughter. And so now the whole movie is he's got to go find her. They took her for her destruction. This Taken is to take us into the presence of God. How many of you have ever had the privilege of being in some sort of a service, or maybe not a service, because I've been in the presence of God where it wasn't in a church service. I've been in the presence of God just one-on-one, which was more remarkable in some ways than anything I've ever experienced in a church service. But how many of you have ever had the opportunity to be in the presence of God where it's just like indescribably delicious? Anybody? Jesus refers to the curious disappearance as a catching away of some, just some, at His coming. 1 Thessalonians says this in chapter 4, verse 16. For the Lord Himself shall descend from heaven with a shout. Now I'm going to read this verse again a little bit, so I'm going to warn you in advance. I'm going to read it again because some of you are going to say, he didn't realize he already read that. For the Lord Himself shall descend from where? Where is Jesus right now? Now, kids, I'll ask you, Mama, have you kids ever asked you, as grandkids, how can Jesus be in heaven and in my heart too? Anybody ever had that one? Well, honey, it's because He's God. That's the best you got. All right. He's going to descend from heaven. Now, remember, Jesus left glory, was born of a virgin, God in the flesh, 100% God, 100% man, lived a sinless life, died on the cross, went to hell, rose again on the third day, 40 days He was seen of His passion, and He ascended into heaven again. And there He is, seated at God's right hand. But He's coming back. Watch this. He's going to descend with a shout, with the voice of archangel, with the trump of God. Boy, I wish I had time to talk about that. And the dead in Christ shall rise first. So some of you got hope. Come on. Or you're in church, the rapture takes place. In an airplane. That's why you never, ever want your pilot to be saved. You get on, you look in that little room, you say, y'all saved? Yes, sir. Well, I'm off of here, boy. Now, it doesn't matter if you're saved. You'd be all right, right? All right, so let's keep going. I'm messing with you. For the Lord Himself shall descend from heaven with a shout, with the voice of archangel, with the trump of God, and the dead in Christ shall rise first. Then we which are alive and remain shall be caught up together. Everybody say, caught up. Together with them in the clouds to meet the Lord where? In the air. I mean, I thought it was pretty cool where I met the Lord. Well, I didn't think it was cool where I met the Lord. I thought it was cool that I met the Lord. How many of y'all met the Lord? And that was pretty cool. But I want you to just imagine, when we shall see Him, we're going to be like Him. Is it not going to be cool that when He comes back for us, born again, blood-bought believers, we're going to be caught up with some of those who have died already in Christ, and we're all going to be caught up with Him in the air? Can you say, whoa! Is that awesome? I mean, just the visual of that is astounding. To meet the Lord in the air, and so shall we forever be with the Lord. Caught up here means, this word caught up, unlike the word taken, means to seize or to carry off by force. You just be living for Jesus. How many of you are supposed to live for Him all the time? You don't get to clock in and clock out as a believer. Well, it's Friday night, 5 p.m. Jesus, I'll see you Sunday. That's not how Christianity works. You clocked in the moment you got saved. You're supposed to 24/7, 365, 366 on a leap year, right? He's going to snatch us up, carry us off by force. You just be living for Jesus. Just walking through the house. That would be cool. Caught up with Him in the Lord, in the air. I mean, is that cool? Would you think you'd just be absorbed with Jesus? I think that would be cool. But surrounded by all the saints of God. Now this is what Morris says. There is often the notion of a sudden swoop, and usually that of a force which cannot be resisted. When that trumpet sounds, with our archangel lets out a loud voice, we see Jesus. Remember, O ye men of Galilee, why stand ye gazing into the clouds, into the heavens? This Jesus whom you've seen go away is coming back the same way you saw him go. Now, the Moonies, Reverend Sung Young Moon, that bunch, anybody know who I'm talking about? Ever buy an incense? Come on. Too long, too far back. He said he was Jesus, and he came in the clouds, in a jet. Whew. And people believe that. How deceived do you have to be to believe that these two guys that addressed the apostles, Jesus that you saw go in the clouds is coming back, but see, they didn't have the revelation of jets back then. William Barclay says on the coming of the Lord, now this is going to help some folks. We can tell there are two sections in Matthew 24, verse, if you'll pull up 32, Matthew 24, 32, we can tell by the signs of nature when summer is on the way. How many of you have noticed? Today is the first day of spring, and we already had spring showers. We've been having spring showers since what? Last 12 months, 8 months ago? I mean, I've been gathering gopher wood now for weeks. You know why they call it gopher wood? Because Noah said to his boys, gopher wood, gopher wood, gopher wood. Did y'all know that? How many of you didn't know that? See what you learn here at Family Church. We can tell by the signs of nature when summer is on the way, so we can tell by the signs of the world when the second coming's on the way. Look at verse 32, and we're just going to read these next few verses. Now learn a parable of the fig tree. A natural thing. When his branch is yet tender and put forth leaves, you know that summer is near. We have some hostas. What's them plants you told me you wanted me to dig up today? And I said, no, I don't want to. Hydrangeas. She didn't want me to. They're about this tall. And I chopped them down. About this high off the ground. Mm-hmm. That's okay. It's okay. It's all right. They've already started budding and flowering already. You know why? Summer is near. Unless you're a horse, summer is nigh. This is all free tonight, by the way. Let's look at verse 33. So likewise, when you shall see all these things, know that it is near, even at the door. Verily I say to you, this generation shall not pass till all these things are fulfilled. Heaven and earth shall pass away, but my word shall not pass away. That's a profound statement right there. That's profound. Now, most biblical scholars, I don't know if it's not all, but certainly most biblical scholars consider Jerusalem, Israel, as the fig tree. And we know what's happened since about, 1948, then 1967 war, miracle events. Now, our president who is making America great again. Yeah. He is, because I got the hat. And our president has now declared what? Jerusalem as the capital. And you'd think the whole world has gone nuts. You want to see them go nuts? Wait till 2020. I don't know how any nuttier this world can get, do y'all? Now, what's this? What makes this interesting is we know that nature shows us in natural things, which Jesus was a master at taking natural things to show us spiritual truth. This fig tree, perhaps representing most likely the nation of Israel. And we see what's been happening now since 1948, actually before that. They were a people with no nation. Boy, if you just study that, it's fascinating to see what God has done. And now, here we are in 2019, and Jerusalem is now the capital. American embassy there. It's fascinating to be living in days that were written thousands of years ago in the Bible. And yet people still question, is the Bible the Word of God?
Hey everybody, it's Perry Black right here at Destined to Win TV, and I want to take a moment to give you a chance to prayerfully consider changing the world. You say, well, how can I change the world? Let me tell you, years ago when I traveled in ministry, before we started Destined Win TV, I had three little girls in Benton, Arkansas, gathered daddy's change every day. And the first of every month, I got a gift from those three precious little girls, changing the world to this day. You can change the world 70 cents a day, $20 a month, by simply taking your change, throwing it into the same spot day after day after day, and then sending it to help us change the world at Second Chance Youth Ranch. Why don't you go right now to cyr.org and we'll answer all of your questions and connect with you if you'll just change the world with your change. I look forward to hearing from you right here at Destined Win TV. Until then, I'll see you here, there, or in the air. God bless. Hi, I'm Perry Black, and I want to take a moment to say thank you, especially to Pastor Caldwell and the VTN team and our great partnership with Second Chance Youth Ranch and VTN and VTN viewers all over the world. Thank you so much for caring about children and changing the world one heart at a time. God bless you. No one knows the time of the second coming, not the angels, not Jesus himself, but only God, and that it will come upon men with the suddenness of a rainstorm out of a blue sky, is what Barclay says. Now, what's fascinating, look at verse 36 through 41. But of that day and hour, no man knows, not the angels of heaven, but my Father only. But as the days of Noah were, so also the coming of the Son of Man be. Now, I want you to remember, you know, they got the big ark now. Has anybody been to the ark? Is it mind-blowing? Fascinating. And here, the days of Noah. What were the days of Noah? It had never rained before. And that this guy is building this gigantic boat, has not one skill tool. Not one electric tool. Totally a green carpenter. The new Green Deal. I mean, he's using chisels. He's not using any fossil fuels. Now, I just happened to be flipping channels. I couldn't help it because I'm a man. And I saw Noah was airing on my 300 channels that I don't watch. And it was Russell Crowe and the Rock People. And a stowaway was on the ark. Help us, Jesus. What were the days of Noah? People's hearts were wicked. They were sinful. They were totally oblivious. Don't you know that that had to be quite a sight, that this crazy old man and his boys, what are they building? We're building a boat. Now to you and I, okay. But to them, what's a boat? Well, what's a boat? Why a boat? Well, because it's going to rain. What's rain? Well, how did the earth grow? A mist would rise up and water the garden. This had to blow their minds. But think about it. Jesus died on the cross. He didn't sneak off somewhere. He died on the cross. They speared him, crucified him, beat him beyond recognition, pulled his beard out by hands full. People still don't believe. And people still say, oh, he was just a historical figure. And some people say, he didn't even live. He's totally mythical. It's mind-blowing. The deception, the darkness, the gross darkness that is hovered over this earth that has been redeemed by the blood of the Lamb. And what's fascinating to me, the longer I serve God, is to see the darkness that has cloaked the minds of unbelievers. But what's most fascinating is the willfulness of believers who say they believe to live in darkness, to choose death over life as if it's a gamble.
just praying that he won't come till I get right. Spiritual roulette. So the thing that's a little bit fascinating here, if you don't understand these two sections, is in this one passage, we know that no man knows. And yet in the previous passage, it says, when you see the fig tree, you know summer's near. So the nature's telling us there are signs, yet we none of us know specifically. Wonder why God is a little vague. Is it because he wants every generation to be ready? Not just every generation, every human to be ready. See, the dilemma is pretty much resolved. And here's how you resolve the dilemma of 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, which I've read a bit of it to you, and I'm going to read some more to you, and Matthew 24, where it flips from signs of his coming, earthquakes, pestilence. Nebraska's underwater. I think California may be in a drought. No longer. They may be in the ocean. They may not have to secede from the Union. They may slide in the ocean. I'm just glad God's not into wrath. We're living in a really interesting time. And yet, if we're not wise, I'm talking about believers. I'm not talking about people who say they believe. I'm not talking about philosophers. I'm talking about true believers, people who actually believe that Jesus is God, that he died and he rose again, paid for our sins, and he's the only way to heaven. You want to create a little issue at work sometime in the next 2 days? Just tell everybody you see at work, everybody, just walk up to everybody you work with and say, I just want you to know Jesus is the only way to heaven. It's not seven doors. You can't hum your way to heaven. You can't Buddha your way there. You're telling me that I don't get a do-over? Jesus is the only way? Well, you're narrow-minded. Pretty much. Because if Jesus is a way, he can only be the way because he said so. See, he can't be a way. He has to be the way because he said, I am the way. Therefore, he can't simply be a way, or he's lying to us when he said, I am the way. Come on. Yeah, but that offends people. I would rather have them offended now that I told them the truth than be offended for eternity in hell because I'm a coward. Do you believe in that Jesus is coming? All right, so here's the dilemma. Here's how you resolve this dilemma when you're reading Scripture, because even I have studied for hours just trying to make sure that what I tell you doesn't confuse you but kind of helps you. One coming, Schofield, I believe in his Schofield Bible, he explained it this way. We're caught up with Jesus, and then he comes back. And so when we study Scripture, Jesus comes for the church, the born-again believer. He comes for the church. That's called the rapture. Now, people say, well, the rapture, that word's never used in the Bible. It's used in the Latin Vulgate from the word rapturus. I don't speak American, so I'm having trouble with Latin. I do pig Latin, by the way. And then he comes with the church. One is the catching up of the church. One is where he comes back with the church to establish his kingdom on earth. That's called the second coming. If you're not diligent in Bible study, you will confuse one with the other and commingle them. And Matthew, Jesus successfully interweaves this. And that's why when you're reading Matthew and you get to that one verse I read earlier, he's actually talking about the church. But then when he's talking about the very elect would be saved, he's not talking about you and I. He's talking about Israel. He's talking about the Jew. Because we're already gone. I'm going to try to get there and show it to you. Revelations 4:1. After this, I looked. Now remember, John's on the Isle of Patmos. He has been caught up in the Spirit on the Lord's day. Man, I read that today. the revelation of Jesus on the Isle of Patmos, where John has been exiled for his faith, is a mind-blowing revelation of Jesus. Anybody read that? You want me to read it to you now? No, I don't have time. And that, you can read, y'all can read Revelation on your own. And after this, I'm feeling like Beethoven. I keep using my hands like this. His name's Robert. After this, After this, I looked, and behold, a door was opened in heaven, and the first voice which I heard was as if it were a trumpet talking. Remember the sound of the trumpet? I read that 1 Thessalonians. Talking with me, which said, "Come up here, and I will show you things which must be hereafter." And immediately I was in the Spirit, and behold, a throne was set in heaven, and one sat on the throne. See, this word rapture is not in the ancient Greek text, but it's in the Vulgate, the Latin Vulgate, which translates the phrase "caught up with rapturus." Now, this is a powerful quote. I can't give credit to the person that I'm quoting, but it's so good. "This is therefore a time not for unkindly criticisms of fellow Christians." Stop. I'm going to interject a parenthesis here. Quit attacking other Christians on social media, please. In parentheses. Oh, let's quit fighting with believers. There's enough demons to keep us busy. We're not each other's enemies. "This is therefore a time not for ungodly criticism of fellow Christians, but for friendly conference," or a conversation. "Not for disputing over divergent views, but for united action. Not for dogmatic assertions and of prophetic programs, but for the humble acknowledgement that we simply now know in part. Not for idle dreaming, but for the immediate task of evangelizing a lost world."
Hi, I'm Perry Black right here at Destined to Win TV, and I want to say thank you for watching our program. You know, we'd love to connect with you, and one way you can do that is join us right here at Family Church Bryant on Sunday morning or on Wednesday night. As you well know, we teach straight from the Word of God with a touch of humor to make the medicine go down. You know, we believe here at Family Church, a church alive is worth the drive. And if you're not connected with a local church, then why don't you visit us? Information right here on the screen. Until then, I'll see you right here at Destined to Win TV. God bless.